I just like to make music. I don't like to really sort of talk about it much, which is why interviews are sort of quite difficult. Like especially for electronic music, because I don't think it's the sort of nature of electronic music. It isn't meant to be talked about.
For most of the 90s, Aphex Twin ran counter to what was happening in mainstream dance music. He was messing with low-key ambience during the forceful Eurodance of Rhythm is a Dancer, moved to harsh industrial noise as Europe was smitten by the dreamy trance of Robert Miles's Children. And when Prodigy and Chemical Brothers ruled the roost, Aphex Twin was attempting to rupture drum and bass with rapid, stuttered, software-programmed beats. The Aphex Twin story is similarly antagonistic, filled with fabrication, half-truths, and provocation, pride from the man himself. Did he own a tank, live in a bank, and do a DJ set using solely sandpaper and a food mixer? Quite possibly. But picking through everything he said for the presence of truth is a foolish exercise. The legend is much more fun than the bedroom-based music geek reality. This is New British Canon, and this is the story of Windowlicker. Born in Ireland, Richard David James grew up in Cornwall, at the isolated foot of England. From a young age, he would dabble with the family piano, soon growing bored with its limited sonic range, and so augmenting the strings with objects to distort its output. This technique, known as prepared piano, is most associated with avant-garde composer John Cage. James was only 12 and unaware of Cage at the time. He just knew that he had the power to change sound to his whims. I bought a synth when I was 12, thought it was a load of shit, took it apart, and started pissing about with it. I got really into making things with electronics. I learnt about it in school until I was quite competent and could build my own circuits from scratch. I started off modifying analog synths and junk that I bought, and I got addicted to making noises. Since he didn't start buying records until much later, his early influences were more hardware in nature. An early touchstone was the game loading sound for the early home computer, the Spectrum ZX81. People who had them must have spent hours listening to that. It's more extreme than any extreme noise music. In time, you got to know the sound really well. Ooh, good bit coming up here. It was always the best, sonically, when it tried to load a picture. It would be... I always wanted to make my music sound like a game, a danceable version of a Spectrum game. At first, he was composing just for his own pleasure, and to drown out the sounds of his sister's Jesus and Mary Jane LPs. Later, he realized via local pirate radio stations that his music sounded like a combination of Chicago acid house. And the techno coming out of Detroit. But ultimately, his music sounded unlike anything else. Despite a lack of actual releases, by his late teens, James was well known in the local free party scene, building his beach party set solely from tracks recorded to C90 cassettes. Early anthem, Didgeridoo, was inspired by the Stone Travelers that had a habit of playing the instrument at these parties. Rather than sample a didgeridoo, James spent 3 days forming the track's primordial drone himself with his collection of customized equipment. But the 146 BPM track had an intended purpose. One of the clubs we used to do had this problem in that we had to shut at 2 a.m. But the atmosphere was so mad that no one wanted to go. So I decided to make some music that was so fucking mad that it would blow their minds and they'd be ready to leave. Didgeridoo was one of those tracks. There's another four that I haven't released. They're too mad. James was more than happy to keep his music to himself and his friends. But rave promoter Mark Darby pursued James for 3 months, eventually signing him to his label Mighty Force, and released Analog Bubble Bath in September 1991. They made me sign the contract when I was off my face. I was tripping and they're waving this money and a pen at me. It's a bit cliched, but that's the way they got me to sign. Analog Bubble Bath was released under the moniker The Aphex Twin. The name was inspired by audio brand Aphex Systems Limited, with the twin added as a nod to his stillborn older brother, after whom he was named. I feel as if I nicked his identity. I reckon he looks after me, like a guardian angel. In his early years, James would release music from various other sobriquets: AFX, Polygon Window, Caustic Window, Bradley Strider, and Power Pill. His logic was that each new persona could be signed to a different label, and he wouldn't have to wait to release something new. In a way, this tied into the anonymous nature of a lot of UK acid house. No personalities, no faces, just slamming tracks. But as the 90s started, dance producers started getting signed, making LPs, even appearing on the UK charts. The inevitable attention from the music press forced many of these often bedroom-based wunderkind to conjure up something semi-interesting to say to interviewers. In this regard, Aphex Twin showed himself to be quite unlike anything else that UK electronica had thus far spat up. In November 1992, Aphex Twin would release his first album, Selected Ambient Works 85-92. It's essentially a greatest hits of his pre-signing period. Some tracks supposedly created when he was in his early teens, with the beatless I being the LP's earliest track. But compared to the unobstructive and minimalist work of Brian Eno, the orbs, little fluffy clouds,
and when it would rain, it would all turn. They were beautiful, the most beautiful skies, as a matter of fact.
And the KLF's Chill Out.
New York, get on the telephone, call 50 your friends.
It didn't really conform as an ambient work, instead demanding attention, especially on tracks like the squelching Green Calx. And the nightmarish throb of Head Phlegm. Although some tracks feature film quotes, such as "We Are the Music Makers" from Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory.
We are the music makers, and we are the dreamers of dreams. We are the music makers, and we are the dreamers of dreams.
And the RoboCop quote from Green Calx. James typically shied away from sampling other records. I don't want to nick someone else's ideas. I don't take anything from anyone. Some people can shed new light on an old tune by sampling it, but that's not what I'm into at all. I want to create things that are original. I get so much more satisfaction out of sounds I made up myself. The whole album was mastered from cassettes that James had shared with friends, resulting in a warm analog glow that stood out from the polished house music that was hitting the charts in 1992. Supposedly, first track, X-Tau, had 6 different points where the tape had warped, thanks to the original cassette being lightly mauled by a cat. The album's lo-fi nature, alongside the mindset of creating an album built for headphones and marijuana rather than a rave, led it to being embraced by students across the UK. Guitar music had typically been students' music of choice. Acts like Primal Scream and the Stone Roses and Happy Mondays had bridged the gap. Aphex Twin was the perfect next step, and the indie press were more than happy to play along. Interviews framed Richard D. James as one of three archetypes: the bedroom prodigy, the fuck everything contrarian, or the media savvy mythmaker. In reality, Aphex Twin encompassed the shifting quantity of all three. He could simultaneously produce all his music with self-customized gear, call acclaimed avant-garde composer Steve Reich boring, and also own a tank. All could be true, but rarely would he talk about his music. Because in essence, he didn't have much to say. When you do so many tracks as I do, like four a day or something, then after a few months it's hard to remember or distinguish what was going on when you made them. Sometimes you remember certain tracks for certain reasons, like you were pissed out of your head and fell through a window. Basically, I can usually remember where I was when I did the track, but that's about it. Internet music snobs, however, looking for a term to elevate Aphex Twin over the rest of acid house and techno, eventually settled on intelligent dance music, or IDM, and looped in other UK producers that were connected socially to James. Music Square Pusher and Orteca. James, though, was dismissive of the label. I just think it's really funny to have terms like that. It's basically saying, this is intelligent, and everything else is stupid. That's really nasty to everyone else's music. Though not charting until 22 years later, selected ambient works 85 to 92 sold steadily, soon growing a reputation as the dark side of the moon of the 90s. The UK head album of choice, with its logo emblazoned on dorm room walls, and ravers t-shirts alike. But his next three albums would take Aphex Twin to a new label and embed him in the electronic mainstream. After Selected Ambient Works 85 to 92, the Twin would sign to Warp Records. The label's stronger presence in the music industry ensured that the conversely fluid yet industrial On would be Aphex Twin's first entry into the UK Top 40. By this time, James had moved to London, giving him better access to other people's music. By his account, he enthusiastically consumed it all, memorizing thousands of records within a couple of years. Not only did he own the majority of acid house and techno on wax, but he took a deep dive into his musical ancestors. Kraftwerk's Weirder Stuff, Wendy Carlos, Terry Riley, Steve Reich. I probably like Steve Reich the best. But this is music I enjoy, not influences. I hate the idea of being influenced. The thought of putting bits of other people's music into my own makes me sick. As the 90s continued, dance music had shifted. Though techno house and ambience still held sway, the peaks and valleys of European trance and the hard breakbeat style of UK jungle was making itself known. I hate trance and I hate jungle, but I'd rather listen to jungle because at least it makes me laugh. When I'm in the car, I always put the Pirates on for 10 minutes. There's about 10 jungle stations in my area and no trance ones. And then my mates and my girlfriend punch me. They hate it, but I can totally see why people get off on jungle. His next album was 1994's double length, Selected Ambient Works Volume 2. A sequel in name, but sonically, more alike to the music for airports ideal for ambient music. 2.5 hours of floating dreamscapes, unsullied by intrusive beats or harsh noise. Though it would hit number 11 on the UK album chart, critics didn't get on with this new release, possibly as a response to James's left-field assertion that he dreamt the whole LP. This is going to sound really weird, but, well, I'm a lucid dreamer, you see. I can control my dreams. I make tracks in my dreams. Sometimes I'm in my own studio, and sometimes in an imaginary studio, and sometimes in my real studio, but with imaginary equipment. I reckon I get about 70% of my stuff that way now. 1995's I Care Because You Do would move away from the ambient sound, with moments of unease verging on noise terror on Ventolin. Beats that blow right past jungle on Come On You Slags. As well as the almost pop haircut percussion of Alberto Balsam. The latter track was named after a shampoo brand, and it was around this time that Aphex Twin would lease his music out for advertising. Most famously, the caustic window track, Garden of Lynn Miri, was used to soundtrack a big budget commercial for Pirelli tires. James had no moral quandaries about advertising. He was more than willing to lend a product some credibility and cool by proxy for the right price. He had submarines to buy, and they ain't cheap. The only time he said no was when an English private healthcare company wanted to use his music. As his family had historically worked for the state-funded NHS, he told them where to go. Extracurricular remixing was also now open to the upcoming producer, which he attacked with his characteristic chaotic manner. The title of his later compilation, 26 Mixes for Cash, clearly exhibited his motivation. It didn't matter the artist nor the amount of contempt James had for them, as long as he was paid. Legend has it he even submitted a Lemonheads mix without any Lemonheads in it. I didn't even bother listening to the song because I knew I'd hate it. Then I totally forgot all about it until the courier turned up to collect it. So I ran upstairs and gave him the first track I found. Strangely, they never released it. They should have been honored, I reckon. It would have sounded better than any rubbish song they wrote. Whereas previous albums had been pieced together with a widening array of synths, sequences, samplers, drum machines, and devices of his own invention, his third album in as many years, the Richard D. James album, was mostly composed on a Macintosh computer. Adapting to new technology and software, the album took longer than the rest, but unrestrained by the linear patterns of drum machine programming, James was free to take his newly glitched beats beyond what was previously thought possible. Sometimes I just hit the keyboard in a way I'd like the rhythm of the track to sound. Then I'll spend 4 hours moving all the notes where I want them to go. Essentially a self-titled album, it was also named in tribute to his stillborn older brother. Preceding its release, the cover of the Girl Boy Song EP would morbidly depict what was allegedly his brother's final resting place, situated in an unknown location in Canada. My mom was so upset about it when he died that she kept his name on but forgot about him, thinking, the next boy I have, that'll be him. So I sort of took his place as if he didn't exist. When you make a record, you've got to put something decent on the sleeve, and I think this is a decent thing to put on the sleeve. Girl Boy Song came about as a challenge from Tom Jenkinson, aka Square Pusher, to see if James was able to make something chart-worthy. My mate was going, it's alright for all you boys making this jungle, but you can't make a decent pop tune. I go, of course I can. During this session, he also formed the pastoral choir boy filth of Milkman, one of the few tracks to feature Richard D. James singing. Despite having no prior knowledge of the instruments, the violins and cellos on the track were played by James himself, though only enough to get a few competent notes, after which he could sample, cut, skew, and pitch shift them to fully orchestrate the track. Girl Boy Song would enter the chart at number 64 before dropping out, despite remaining as prolific as ever. With only two albums left on his initial contract with Warp, James felt he might be winding down the whole record-making part of his career. He was fed up with the music business, having already made more money than he was ever going to be able to spend. The more recent music he had written, he claimed, was too advanced for the public, and so he preferred not to release it, as other artists would try and fail to copy him. But before James retired, he would have two unlikely shots at the mainstream. By 1996, Big Beat had taken over as the dominant, populist form of UK dance music. There was the release of Fatboy Slim's debut single, Everybody Needs a 303. The Chemical Brothers returned with their Noel Gallagher featuring number one, Setting Sun. And Prodigy sent kids scurrying behind their sofas after Top of the Pops aired the video for their number one, Firestarter. I'm a firestarter, twisted firestarter. As the name suggests, this subgenre was all about the drums. Not necessarily fast or intricate, but bone-crushingly heavy. It was big, dumb, and mainstream-minded, and the polar opposite of IDM. Whereas Big Beat was made to dance to, Aphex Twin and his producer friends were taking it the other way. Post-jungle with irregular, software-developed beats that defied four-to-the-floor rhythm. It was called Drill and Bass, pioneered by Luke Filbert. And like most things with this crowd, a piss take. Though James had dipped his toes on the Hangable Autobulb EP, and on the Richard D. James album.
Yep.
He would take this style to the charts with his 1997 single, Come to Daddy. Its James vocal hook had been inspired by a deranged piece of fan mail. I did the track in its original form about 2.5 years ago. The same day I received this mad letter from this fan that ended with, I want your soul. I will eat your soul. I couldn't make head or tail of it at all, but I thought it sounded pretty good. With heavily distorted guitars, and an absolutely unhinged, almost blast beat drum track, James described it as this crappy death metal jingle, and its aggro to the max nature has been seen as a parody of either Nine Inch Nails or Prodigy's Firestarter. Come to Daddy became iconic because of its Chris Cunningham-directed video. A nightmarish H.R. Geiger trip through a council estate, haunted by kids with familiar visages. James, though, didn't like how the video somewhat overshadowed his music. It was just so detailed, almost to the beat, in the way it pictorially represented the music. This isn't a criticism of Chris, because I love his work, but if I had a criticism, it would be that it's wrong to tie the music down to a single visual image like that. thanks to the outrage and shock that the video was accumulating, Come to Daddy was set to do serious numbers on the UK singles chart. But James wasn't having it. Come to Daddy was gonna go well massive, not in America, but over here. It got to about 16 in the charts, and it was on the way to the top. I had to withdraw the record for a week, just so it would drop out again. I just about kept the lid on it. I think it's bad to be really well known, because you end up in people's faces, whether they like you or not. That's a really horrible thought. Contrary to James's claim, Come to Daddy only got to number 36. The week it peaked, if it would have hit the top spot, it would have denied Elton John's Candle in the Wind, 1997, its fifth week at number one.
Goodbye, England's rose. May you ever grow in our hearts.
Just for reference, Candle in the Wind, 97, is still the biggest selling single of all time in Britain. No matter what, Aphex Twin wasn't going to shift it. However, his next single, 1999's Windowlicker, did make it to number 16. With its 6-minute runtime and burbling, ever-shifting structure. Windowlicker doesn't instantly strike you as something that would fit amongst the Baby One More Times or Mambo No. 5s of the UK chart in 1999. By the same time, it is full of hooks, though in typically Aphex Twin fashion, the main melody line is composed of various contorted, orgasmic moans. But before that hook kicks in, is a 30-second IDM breakbeat breakdown, a bravado piece of software beat programming. It's quite similar to the guitar solos, only with programming you have to use your brain. The most important thing is that it should have some emotional effect on me, rather than just, oh, that's really clever. There's a lot of melancholy in my tracks. The chorus, as it is, seems to be an obscured approximation of the title. But there is only one other lyric in the song. In the bridge, James's French then-girlfriend, delivering the line. But what does this mean? Aphex Twin strikes again. It translates to, I like to make dog food. It's gibberish. With its slinky synth bass and sexual theming, not to mention the track's video, many saw Windowlicker as James's deconstruction of modern R&B. However, the song was written originally around the release of the Richard D. James album in 1996, and his inspiration most of the time was himself. I could just lock myself away for days and get inspired by myself. That's my favourite way to do it. It's more like a pure form of motivation when it's all on your own. But you have to wait until you're really bored and you've got nothing to do. That's when it comes out. That's when I reckon it gets good. The same way his debut was a collection of his best work so far, Windowlicker is a guided tour of the last decade of Aphex Twin, the breakbeat meltdowns of the Richard D. James album. The ambient La 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 bridge that recalls X-Tao. The moments of pop euphoria present on Alberto Balsam. And the 2-minute distorted noise coda a la Come to Daddy. All this while remaining fresh, innovative, and years ahead of his contemporaries. The video itself was surprisingly even more disturbing than the one for Come to Daddy. Rather than James as a dozen ominous children, instead as an army of scantily dressed models. As far back as the cover of I Care Because You Do, and the video clip for Donkey Rhubarb, Richard had been using his face as an additional logo, purposely making his visage as grotesque as possible, commenting on dance music being a faceless medium by oversaturating the visuals of his work with his face. Following the videos for Come to Daddy and Windowlicker, he would take this concept to its logical endpoint by literally placing his face into his music. On the Windowlicker EP track, usually referred to as Formula, there is a hidden Easter egg near its climax. If viewed via a spectrogram, within the frequencies, you will see a manic smiling portrait of Richard D. James. Now that his face was literally everywhere, it was time for him to take some time away from the spotlight. Released in March 1999, Windowlicker remains the best-selling song released on Warp Records. But as always, the mainstream sound of dance music had shifted. Big Beat had given way to French House. Daft Punk had made their name with Around the World. While Monsieur Oiseau's Flatbeat topped the UK charts. But being the hottest thing in experimental electronica, Madonna sought out James for a collaboration, as she had previously done for Björk and William Orbit, and later with the Neptunes, Timbaland, Diplo and Sophie. A collaboration he denied her. I'm not interested in doing it just to make millions, like a lot of other people. If I did it, that's all interviewers would have talked about for the rest of my career. Her whole career has been like, oh, they're the trendy person of the moment. I'll work with them to make me younger. They're using you. After earning his biggest pop hit, the plan seemed to be for Aphex Twin to stop making records for a while. That was until fate forced his hand and Drugs was released in October 2001. Basically, I had 180 unreleased tracks on an MP3 player, which I left on a plane. That's why I released this album, because all of those were on it. And I thought, they're gonna fucking come on the internet sooner or later, so I might as well get an album out of it first. Though he released bits and pieces via his alter egos, fans waited 13 years for him to release another album as Aphex Twin, 2014's Syro. But in this relative absence, the repercussions of his work made themselves known throughout electronic music and beyond. Sure, there's the various cerebral takes on electronica of the Warp family. The likes of Orteca, Squarepusher, Music, Plug, Boards of Canada, and Flying Lotus. Not to mention Death Grips, 1-0 Tricks, Point Never, and the weirdest stuff from Grimes. But dubstep as a genre has his grubby fingerprints all over. Both the underground UK variety and the Skrillex-driven US brostep mutation. A.G. Cook of PC Music's attempt to cover Windowlicker suggests that Twin's excessively active chops and changes influenced hyperpop. But even the more avant-garde producers of turn-of-the-century chart pop were cribbing from James through a bubblegum filter. See, for example, the stuttering, glitchy pop from NSYNC. Or the cut and screw from early Timbaland. And even the acclaimed album Kid A, Radiohead themselves would admit is them attempting to be Aphex Twin. But strangest of all, the soundtrack to Minecraft, at least to James's ears. My kids were playing that, and I thought that sounds pretty much like some of mine. Thank you. And then this guy Notch, who made that game, bought one of my records on eBay for $40,000. My kids loved it. They told all their friends in school. That was pretty cool. As time has progressed, the myths about Aphex Twin have calcified into fact. Though he himself is aware of the ripples of what he said 3 decades ago, he doesn't think about it too much. Focusing on your own self-aggrandizement is never healthy. But it all comes down to the form of electronic music. When interviewed by the rock press, James needed to give music without lyrics, without stories, and narrative. As the old idiom goes, writing about music is like dancing about architecture. Richard D. James is that concept, writ large. That's why I love making music so much. You're not limited by vocabulary and words. You will fall into patterns and trends, but you can access whatever you want. You can't do that with language. Yeah, you could look up some more words, I suppose, but it's infinite with art, with music. That's the best bit about it, basically. Thanks for watching. So what is your favourite Richard D. James album, song, project, whatever? Let me know by commenting down below. If you like this video, like, subscribe, and why don't you also do me a favour and share it with a couple of people? It really does help. I'd also like to shout out my new top tier members over on Patreon. Rafe Payne, Rachel, Christopher Speaks, Joni Kuntz, Cooler567, and Michael Briggs. Thank you so very much to all that support me. And I'll see you in a month's time for another Genre History.